Thank you. Thank you. Hey, everybody. If we could kind of get you to quiet down, thank you. So we first of all like to thank all of you for coming out tonight. We've had a long path to get to where we are, being a new student group, getting everything going. Again, this fall was a long process. We've been working hard, though, and it's good to see we got a little bit of support here, at least. We need to thank our group members, people around the state, all of you in the community, our great donors. We got to thank all of them because without them, the event is not possible. And we are going to be donating a portion of the money we have raised to the Intrepid Fallen Heroes Fund. So there'll be a donation bucket. You can drop something in there if you appreciate us in the event or want to just give some money to veterans. We'll have all that for you. And again, without people like the donors, people working hard in the group, the amazing crew at Breitbart, all of Milo's team, we couldn't have gotten it done. Press has been pretty good to us, even though this is real news. Real news right there. So, I mean, I don't think you guys want to listen to me talk for much longer. So before I leave the stage here, I got to pull it up. Last week, prior to the Dangerous Faggot Tour stop at Michigan State University, Milo and his team found out about a protest that was planned, and protesters were trying to stop the event, just like they said they were going to do here. How'd that work out? As some of you have seen, their response was great. Before Milo comes out, we're going to play a short video here quick, and they'll play that for us.
Why do you want them?
Because we can get rare ones and then make money. Can I get Yu-Gi-Oh cards, please, Dad? Is that a yes?
Stop it.
Is that a yes?
Stop it.
That's a yes, baby.
What we knew to expect was just the same stupid shit that happens all the other times when people want to get mad. We knew that there was like a big Facebook event that they were setting up at like 5 p.m. so they could go over there and just yell for 2 hours.
No.
Why?
Because I hate your penguin.
Come on!
Wait, let's get one Pokemon.
I threw it at Mike, not you. I'm just gonna go win another one.
No, you're not.
No, I'm not.
No, you're not.
We don't usually get protests that big. Usually, okay. The protests are just events held across the hallway, and it's usually just a safe space for people that are too scared to actually protest.
The people that hide in other events, they're gay.
Yeah.
They're gay.
Bitches.
They're stupid and they're gay. They're definitely not Dwayne. My friend Dwayne is cool.
Even though he's small.
Dwayne kicked my ass at Disney World in front of all my friends. I crossed him and he double blasted me through a freaking doorway.
Do you have black clothes? Yeah? All right.
Our strategy to counter the protesters was just infiltrate them, make them look like fools, and that we did.
Let's get this.
All right.
We made signs and everything.
We're gonna
things wrong like Ben did.
Well, I don't want to make it too obvious, but we have like a Milo. I mean, I should have a big one saying Milo sucks because it's so obvious. People are gonna be watching. Like, you'll see the video, and people will be like, "How did they not realize?"
The signs that we had the one that said. It was like, fuck racism, we're spelled wrong, and on the back it said, fake gay, go away. And that was just funny because people think that he's not gay, so he's just faking it to get, like, attention. And then we had another one, end white supremacy, and on the back of that it said, Milo hates me because I'm black. It's a totally viable message, by the way. Would I consider myself black? Depends on the day. Sometimes on Tuesday I'm feeling a little... different, I guess. I consider myself trans fluid. What sparks these transitions? I don't know. Maybe chemicals in my brain, some receptors that are a little fried.
Full moon.
Full moon. other things like just the tides when they change, the altitude sometimes. I mean, like, I've been up at 8,000 feet and I was feeling just straight Caucasian, you know? Are you tired? Yeah, and that's real.
Why didn't you put black at high altitudes? Why can't they be high up?
When I get into an airplane, I become Muslim.
To get on site, we're going to be in full disguise. We're going to walk to the site from an area where they won't see us coming out of the car. And we're going to infiltrate. We're going to stay there for about, you know, 5, 10, 15 minutes, depending upon how many of them there are. If there's less, we don't have as much time. If there's more, we probably have a little bit more time.
By infiltrating the protest, we're kind of holding a mirror up to them. And then they look in it and they're like, I'm fat and I'm stupid and I'm dumb.
Once we're at a point where I feel like we've had enough time, I will make sure I'm near Milo, and I will make sure that security's got eyes on me, and I will say as loud as I possibly can, fuck Milo. That is Milo's cue to take off his mask and do his thing.
We're going to go and protest my own event. I've picked a sign that is both, well, I mean, it's true whichever way you look at it.
We went in there and acted like we were part of the protest.
Stop letting bigotry into our schools!
Infiltrating because when he took his mask off.
Yeah, everyone seemed excited.
There's only got one black guy with dreads.
Everyone else seemed like excited.
That's the guy who said that I couldn't say I was black. I said that I was black and some guy said that I wasn't. And then I said, why can't I be black? And he said, because you're not black. And I said, I'm black. And he said, no. I can't be black, I guess. Do I want to be black? No. But I'd like to be able to be black if I want.
I guess to get back at us when that happened, after the whole Milo taking his mask off and everything, there's maybe 6 or 8 people holding a banner that said something like we won't let them pass or something like that, and they're trying to block us off. I think they decided to block the doors because they just wanted to keep people outside from getting the good word from this man over here.
The good word from the Dwayne.
The police said, hey, you guys need to get out of the way or we're going to start using force. And that's when me and him were like, yeah, I'm not getting shot with a beanbag. I'm out of here. So we walked off, and then everyone started getting arrested and everything.
When we woke up the next day, they were in jail. And they posted a GoFundMe page to get them out. Milo's response to the protesters was sending them $17.76. Really to teach them a lesson. And 2 years in prison will definitely do that. doinked by Tyrone?
I think these professors need to fear us, and mostly Milo, because he's the one that does everything. But because once they start acting a fool, we go out there and make them look a fool, and then...
Bull.
Precisely. If you're not going to change what you're going to do, you should probably just quit and stop being an idiot.
Or you can stand on the firing wall. The
figurative
of debate, of civil debate, not bullets, words.
Where nine people are just going to be telling you you're wrong, where you stand right over there.
With words.
Precisely.
Not guns.
These people need to just stop acting stupid and either quit teaching.
We're not killing anyone.
We're killing them kind
of. Reading the words to them.
We put their email on a giant screen that thousands of people see. They're going to have to make a new email after that because you're just going to get it constantly. People saying whatever the hell. You're not going to get any work done because you're not going to see a work email.
Send them Papa John's advertisements.
This experience at MSU taught me that if I don't like someone and I'm smart enough about it, I can have them locked in prison for 2 years.
Isn't it nice?
We decided since Milo came to the state of hockey, we needed to get him Mavericks hockey jersey.
Oh, thank you. Thank you. I'm so happy. Oh, thank you so much. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you so much. Thank you so much. Thank you. Thank you very much.
You're welcome.
Thank you. Thank you so much. Oh, this is lovely. Look at this little Christmas thing. Isn't it nice? Wonderful, wonderful. Right, I'm going to put this down here. Oh, now some of you have dressed up this evening, but not all of you. Let's fix that. Let's have some little hats. I want you to see. You want little hats? Come on, I'm going to dress up the front row. Come on. You have one. Here we go. I've got some little gifts, you know, because I am one of life's givers. Well, stop, what have we got? I don't even know. Bernie Sanders. Outsider in the White House. No, you're fucking not. Who wants this? Now, mind yourselves, be careful. There we go. What have we got here? Oh, this is a real present. Look at, what is this? Hand lotion? Oh, a lady wants this. Who wants this? Who has a lady to give this to? Somebody, you do? Okay, there we go. There we are. Oh, right. Oh. Now I know. Oh, there's other stuff in here too. It smells nice, and there's chocolates, but I can't have those. Everybody has a copy of this already, don't you? But, all right. Be careful. I'm gonna get in trouble. All right, we'll do the rest later. No, I get in trouble. I threw the protest sign, and the county district prosecutor is asking the police to look into charges against me for throwing my protest sign. I swear that's true. I think the police liked us. I think that's why they... they were what is it, 7 of them, and 5 of them were up for felony charges? How awful. I feel just dreadful about it. I do. I feel terrible about it. Right, I've got to find this thing for you so I can start talking to you. Well, thank you for having me. Now, one thing you might not know, you probably don't know this, is I've become, in the space of the past week, a feminist icon. I have. It's true. I've become a feminist icon. You want to know why? So at my previous date at UW Wisconsin, I happened to put on the screen the image, a picture
of a nice young man who thinks he's a lady, and used the law, because of course progressives always, when they don't get what they want or want to get in somewhere that they don't belong, invoke the great patriarchal force known as the government, to try to get into the women's locker rooms. This young man was desperate for a bit of tit and minge. So he tried via the government to get himself into the women's locker rooms at UW Milwaukee. Now, it created a terrible fuss, an awful fuss, when I put his name up there, and so did the president of that university. But it turns out he's going to quit the university, so I have become a sort of second wave feminist icon, protecting women from men in their locker rooms. Well, you're welcome, feminism. Now, this young person, sometimes they say I'm mean, sometimes they say it's too much, sometimes they say you're too vindictive, it's too cruel. But the point of doing this is that, you know, they invoke the government, they use the government to get a variety of things through that ordinary normal people would not permit. And then this person, Justine, or Adelaide, or whatever he calls himself this week. It's Christmas, I don't care anymore. Adelaide, good Lord. Went to the press and said that I had used violent words, as though violent words were a thing. What the fuck is a violent word? If you can't take a joke, how are you going to deal with having your dick cut off? Just ask. Anyway. The last show before Christmas. I've been given free rein. Right, Christmas is next week, or almost next week. Can you believe that? Maybe you have finals before the winter break, and I'm sure there would be more protesters here, but they're all finishing their last term paper, Why All White Men Are Literally Hitler. It's amazing. They've all arrived at the same title. Absolutely incredible from reading BuzzFeed. They've all decided that they're going to write the same thing. I'm very happy to come here today. At one point, it was not clear that the Dangerous Faggot Tour would be able to make an appearance at Minnesota State. Your school tried to join a growing wave of universities imposing last-minute security fees on the events, as though there was any risk to anyone at these events except to us from crazy students that the university have enabled. So in other words, it says, on the one hand, it's a sort of way that they admit that they've created a monster, but also blame me for it. We have no faith that the insane social justice lunatics that we have pandered to, funded, and provided for will be able to restrain themselves from physically assaulting you. So we're going to charge you $2,000 3 days before the event. And if you can't afford that, Milo can't come. Well, there's a reason that Fire.org calls this censorship by another name, fee speech. But fortunately, your school has rolled over. And you do have a very free speech-friendly president, I understand, who was instrumental in getting this restored. So thank you to him, and that's very, very good news. My tour doesn't charge appearance fees, as most people know, and we're not going to let cowardly university administrations shut us down with surprise costs given to students. And when it happens, we will name them, and we will shame them, and as is the case for most universities, Minnesota State came to their senses. I mean, it just makes me... Do I look dangerous to you? Do I look dangerous? Is this the face of somebody who needs to be kept to... What? Is this the face... Somebody had a little episode in the back. Is this the face of somebody that students need to be protected from? Well, maybe now you think of it, but nobody needs security just because the speaker is conservative. Get a grip, and any time your colleges claim that this is the case, ask them, when was the last time that a liberal, that a progressive, that a left-wing speaker had $2,000, $3,000, or $8,000 worth of security fees imposed on them at the last minute? The answer, of course, will be never. Now, Minnesota was in the news again last week involving the other school I spoke at, the University of Minnesota, once upon a time. Turns out web ads they purchased ended up on Breitbart, where I work. It wasn't an ad specifically placed there. It was one of those Google things, you know, just sort of serves up ads wherever. The school received, quote, a small but vociferous email campaign, meaning 11 angry lesbians. In other words, the entire gender studies department. I'm sorry, are you implying there are heterosexual women in the gender studies department? Heterosexual women in the gender studies department? I think not. Nobody likes Dick could behave that badly to men. No, just look through your faculty list. Dyke, 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 divorcee, dyke. It's true. Why do you think they're all so mad? So angry with everything. They're good dicking. Sorry, but it's true. Anyway, the key point is the campaign was very small, but the University of Minnesota caved anyway. Apparently, it's the message that it's sending is that 45 million people who read Breitbart are hateful, misogynistic, racist, anti-Semitic, sexist bigots, and they want nothing to do with them. Interesting way of dealing with social justice complaints. Tiny little social, the little whinging morons who've done so much to destroy joy and fun and to stamp out any sort of mischief and irreverence from life, such as Christmas. They hate Christmas. We'll come on to that in a minute. They hate Christmas. Who do you think, by the way, goes to sports events? Because the University of Minnesota ad was for their sports events. It was advertising sports events. Do you think it's 45 million readers at Breitbart, or is it bitter lesbian vegans commenting on toxic masculinity at Gizmodo and the Huffington Post? I think I know which website is more likely to produce good ticket sales. When, I ask you, did the customer is always right become the customer is a bigoted, hate-filled, Nazi misogynist? When did that happen? Excuse me. When did that happen? Sooner or later, advertisers are going to start thinking with their pocketbooks instead of their politics. Conservatives like you are a huge market. In fact, you are the market because you actually have jobs. You can buy things. You can buy things. Look at what happened to Kellogg's. Poor Kellogg's. Poor Kellogg's. Stock price crashing. And all of these, so many Breitbart, I mean, was it hundreds of thousands of people? Breitbart readers now weaning themselves off cereal. It's like crack, this stuff. Like breakfast crack for fatties. Frosted Flakes. It's disgusting, by the way. It is horrible, tasteless, sugar-laden food for fat people. And you should stop eating it anyway. But just goes to show what happens when you pick a fight with me or with Breitbart or anything, or with, of course, our readers and conservatives in America who are tired of being lied to and lied about and who demonstrated that, who gave a very clear message to the elites in America and to left-wing corporate America that supported Hillary Clinton. Very clear message at the last election by doing what? Voting in Donald Trump, of all people, to send a message that conservative America was tired of being lied to and lied about. But let us, Daddy, yes, his name is Daddy. But let us speak of happier things. We're here to celebrate, after all. I'd like to start off the main portion of this evening's talk with a simple phrase, one you're not really supposed to say in American polite society. You're not supposed to have it up on signs. You're not supposed to have it in public places. That phrase is Merry Christmas! Merry Christmas! Now, to many liberals, this is going to be the most triggering thing I have said on my entire tour. And I have said some pretty triggering things. I've said some pretty bad things about feminists, lesbians, hate crime hoaxers. The first three are all the same people. Muslims. Bit quieter. Cyclists. Democrats. The unemployed. Vapors. The obese, cross-dressers, you name it. Anyway, Donald Trump, Daddy, has made no bones of the about... No, that's what I call him. You don't know that? No, I made that up. If you've ever seen that somewhere, you know, I made it up because it annoys everyone. Like, there's literally no one who isn't irritated by it. Like, well, what do you mean? That's kind of sick. And I'm like, well, he's just Daddy, isn't he? He's just Daddy. He's just Daddy. Look at him. Look at him. It's just Daddy. Donald Trump has made no bones about his support for the phrase Merry fucking Christmas, although he didn't put the fucking in there. He said in front of Christmas trees during his victory tour, looking like a god. Contrast this with President Obama, whose traditional presidential Christmas cards don't even say Christmas on them this year. Incidentally, he's only the fourth president in American history to use his own picture, a picture of himself, on his Christmas card. The only ones to do it before were Herbert Hoover, FDR, and of course, the Clintons. Obama and Hillary, of course, being the two most egotistical people ever to be attracted to what is already, let's be honest, quite an ego-driven job. If Hillary had won the presidency, her Christmas card, of course, would have had her, it was a bit of a helicopter panorama of her and her 128 strong medical staff. that would have been a nice one. They'll take the picture from the helicopter. Bill still wouldn't be in it. Maybe Chelsea's dad would. I'm just saying. Well, you're allowed to say about the Palins. We can say it about you. Go fuck yourselves. Now, as recently as a few years ago, I thought the war on Christmas was a bit of a joke. I'll be completely honest with you, but it isn't. It is... I think I'm being trolled by my... those two nice gentlemen you saw in the video. Why? No, it's all right. I did honestly think that it was just a bit of a joke. I thought it was just Christians getting upset about nothing. And some of their tactics seem similar to what we see today from social justice warriors. I thought they were sort of social Jesus warriors. You know, sort of language policing and moaning and whinging and organizing kind of mobs and things like that. But I've realized, having looked into it, not only... Well, there are two reasons it's different. One is that feminism is evil, toxic, conspiratorial, and ludicrous, and Christianity is really quite cool. And the other is actually the war on Christmas, unlike the patriarchy, the wage gap, and campus rape culture, is actually real, actually a thing, actually exists. And we're going to just skip through a few examples of that. When I realized the war on Christmas was real, I did start to look for examples. And I found lots of them. I realized not only is there a war on, but Christians are losing it. And in their rush to placate anyone and offend no one, especially our friends from the Middle East, the left wants to shut down Christianity. Now, from the liberal reaction to Christmas, you would think Santa and his reindeer took down the Twin Towers. Too soon? Some of you were barely born. I remember where I was. No, never mind. I'm supposed to say that about when Diana died. You know Princess Diana? You know, Slut. She was. You think Harry's Prince Charles's? Of course not. So good looking. How could he be the progeny of that old thing? Charles looks like a gonad. Harry is, you know, the only hot ginger ever to have lived. Or maybe they believe. It was Christmas shoppers who attacked non-believers with a knife in a Minnesota mall. Yeah, see, I do my homework. No, I'm just kidding, they're all Muslims. Now, the exact people the left is trying to placate are, in many cases, America's burgeoning Islamic community. They honestly believe that if they grovel hard enough, they won't be murdered. They also believe if they squeeze their eyes hard enough and say magic words, Tinkerbell will make Hillary Clinton president. But alas, neither is true. it's not a leap to think for liberals that Muslims will someday love gays. They'll just magically wake up one day and be totally cool with the whole dick-sucking thing. If only they hug them hard enough. Well, newsflash, ladies, it's not a boner, it's a bomb. I told you I've been let off the leash this evening. Now, Just like feminism and identity politics, the left has concentrated its efforts on young people like you. An annual poll by a public religion research institute shows that 66% of Americans under 30, so you lot, all of you, support saying happy holidays instead of Merry Christmas. No. Only 39% of those over 65 feel the same way. Here is a graphical representation of... Here's a graphical representation of that 66% of millennials who believe that we should say happy holidays instead of Merry Christmas. Old people know our country is in trouble, besides the Christmas thing, but when they tell kids to get off their lawn, these days the kids reply, actually, the lawn is the property of Native Americans and it was stolen by the white man, so maybe you should get off your lawn. The war on Christmas, however, continues unabated. It's just about the only concept held sacred by the progressive left, which is diversity, which basically means no white people, no straight people. Nobody normal. I heard that. Strap yourselves in, there's a lot more coming. The war on Christmas continues unabated. It is about the only concept they hold sacred. Anything that promotes or supports the cult of diversity is good. Anything that is not inclusive is bad. In the minds of a liberal, someone who isn't Christian would be offended if we say Merry Christmas, so we shouldn't say Merry Christmas to anyone. This is insane. Completely insane. I think the problem is that most leftists only know people like themselves. Miserable atheists who don't believe in anything except the authoritarian control of speech and thought by the government. I know all sorts of people. Wasn't even a joke, but thanks. I know plenty of people. I know all sorts of people. I might wander up. I mean, I'm sort of technically Jewish, but sort of Jew-ish, you know. It's all right, most of them are better. I was raised Catholic, so, you know, I might walk up to somebody and say Merry Christmas, not realize they were, you know, one of the chosen people, and might say, what? I can say that. And you know, they say, I'm Jewish. And I'd be like, oh, I'm sorry, well, Happy Hanukkah, or whatever I might say, you know. Most of the people I interact with are obviously celebrating Kwanzaa, but... what? That was nice! I was being nice! But whatever I say, the normal way to interact with well-adjusted, functioning human beings would just be say, oh, actually, I'm Jewish. Oh, okay. Oh, actually, I'm Muslim. Okay. Just kidding. This is how normal people operate in normal social situations. The only people who don't celebrate Christmas and can't mentally process Merry Christmas anything except a hate crime are people looking to be offended. The sorts of people who wander around waiting to say, excuse me, that's really inappropriate. What the secular, soulless left fails to understand is that most people aren't as eager to take offense at everything as they are. Most people quite like to have a laugh. Most people quite like to be joyful. Most people quite like to have fun. And most people like Christmas. Most people like celebrating Christmas, irrespective of their religious beliefs. You know, most people, you know, even atheists, use it as an excuse to come together to spread joy, love, and harmony, things that social justice warriors loathe. Lots of non-Christians around the world celebrate Christmas too, because who doesn't like exchanging presents? I particularly like receiving. but I also sometimes give. Now, these are the... Here's somebody who hasn't received in quite some time. Jessica Valenti. Why? What was that? It's going to land on her. Obama, Hillary, Valenti. No, I will not wrap all the presents. Why are women still responsible for holiday joy? What would you know about joy, you funless prick? Anyway, these are the sorts of people who don't like Christmas. The typical government and socialist drone intent on shutting down Christmas. She'd be terribly triggered by somewhere like Hong Kong. Any of you ever been to Hong Kong? No, well, Hong Kong is a city of many religions. Buddhism, Confucianism, Kung Paoism, Chicken Chow Mainism. I made some of those up. But they have lots of Christmas... The point is, they have lots of Christmas displays in Hong Kong. There's no snow in Hong Kong. Most people in Hong Kong have never seen snow. But they have it because they enjoy it, they appreciate it. It's a sort of nice thing to do. They recognize Christmas as joyful and lots of fun, and they put substance above diversity and offense-taking, just like we should. Leftists wage the war on Christmas using their traditional methods, government, fiat, and the court system. They never win voting, and they certainly don't win in the free market, so they bravely fight their battles through big government instead. Every year, and this is one of my favorite things to do every year, the Beckett Fund for Religious Liberty hands out an Ebenezer Award for the most insane government attack on Christmas and or Hanukkah. Now, a few recent winners are great. So 2015, the Department of Veteran Affairs won. Now, I hope Trump fixes this particular department, which seems from what I read to be the most appallingly badly run government department. It should be the best run government department. But in 2015, it won the Ebenezer Award for banning employees from saying Merry Christmas to veterans. They also banned singing Christmas carols in public spaces in their buildings. The Department of Veteran... What? No, yes. They really did. And this is the Department of Veterans Affairs under Obama. The 2012 award went to Governor Lincoln Chafee of Rhode Island. Have you heard of this guy? He's absolutely excellent. He renamed the state's Christmas tree to be the official holiday tree of Rhode Island. And in 2011, he was so embarrassed when people gathered at the tree to sing "O Christmas Tree." In 2012, he only gave 30 minutes notice to the town for the lighting ceremony. So he only gave people who lived there, who paid taxes, who paid him to install this thing, 30 minutes notice, so not enough people would be able to get down there to sing "O Christmas Tree" when he turned the lights on the holiday tree. The 2012 winner was narrowly victorious over the city of Santa Monica, which shut down a nativity scene that had been displayed for more than 50 years. 50 years, but it suddenly wasn't good enough for Santa Monica. Residents got around that by staging a live nativity performance instead. You know, sort of mischievous dissidents, Christians. You don't think of Christians as being sort of hell racers and mischief makers, but they do have their moments. There are more and more attacks on Christmas all the time, and they come from always from one political direction, always emboldened by the engorged government apparatus in this country. I was just over in Indiana visiting Memories Pizza. Wonderful family, wonderful little place, good pizza. Totally fucked over by cunts in the media. And now there's a little town called Knightstown, which has removed the cross from their Christmas tree because the ACLU sued them to get it taken down. It is crazy. Now, if anyone still thinks the war on Christmas isn't real, I invite you to explain to the residents of Knightstown why the ACLU threatened them with a lawsuit. It's insane. It is just like Memories Pizza, but even crazier. I'd like to talk to you more about pizza, but I may get myself into trouble, so we're going to save that for another... No, there's no need to groan. I'm not allowed. I've been banned. I can't talk to you about it. I'm kidding. This is no singing of Christmas. One example of Christians fighting back in the war on Christmas came up last year with Starbucks cups. It sort of stopped being funny and now it's being funny again. Starbucks cups, which are from Starbucks, looked like this a little while ago, and people were so mad about it So mad about it that this year Starbucks has had to bring them back, but with sort of customer designs. Starbucks capitalizes on Christmas with Christmas blends, Christmas tree ornaments, and all sorts of other touches. They just want everyone to like them. And this is one of the ways that social justice wins. It suggests to people that the way for everyone to like you and for your life to go well is to not offend anyone. Well, that's really not how to be popular and likable. That's how to turn yourself into an oppressive, miserable, joyless, funless cunt. So don't do that. I don't think that Starbucks actually really hates Christmas. They just want people to love them. But when Christmas is under siege, it sends a different message to conservatives, to Christians, or even really to anybody who wonders what the agenda really is behind all of this stuff. At least when Starbucks made their move, they kept it low-key. Braver leftists, I'm sure, would have done something more provocative with the Starbucks cup. Not just removing Christmas, but perhaps adding Islamic religious symbols, just for the sake of diversity. Islam, after all, is a religion of peace, and is how we should all live our lives, according to the Democrat Party. No, Hillary's team in the morning, after they've read their morning prayers in the direction of Mecca, get up and work out new ways that they can persuade people that that we should do away with Christianity and replace it with something else. And I'm glad they didn't do that, of course, because this sort of move always backfires. There would be some sort of fatwa issued against these cups for violating an obscure rule in the Sharia that Islamic symbols must never be placed on intoxicants, and we'd have loads of Oregonian lesbian baristas with throats cut. which actually doesn't sound so bad when you put it like that. Maybe that's all right. Oh. I love that USA has become the sort of... Oh, you wish, baby. Oh. I wish they'd come and ask questions. I want them to come and ask... What's that, darling? No. The sad reality is I don't need to. I mean, I would. I'd be perfectly happy to stage a bit of drama, you know, it'd be like one of those plays where the actors are planted in the audience, you know. I'd be perfectly happy to do it. No, I'm sorry to tell you, your campuses really are this crap. I want them to stay, I want them to ask questions, but all they can do is shout names, call you names, get scared off by Navy SEALs. And then run with their tails between their legs at the sound of something that scares them more than anything else. Patriotism. And you guys shouting USA. It's telling that you have come up with this... Look, they ran away. She ran. She was like, USA, I'm getting out of here. Good heavens. Do you know the hell I had to go through as a European just to get a visa to be allowed to be here? And these ungrateful monsters born in the greatest country in the history of human civilization get sent packing by a US agent. Anyway, anyone else wants to make a little spectacle of themselves, please do it now. No? Good, okay. Now, Starbucks was a win in the end, because... not that one, but... So to make clear to the lawyers, we are in no way implying that Subway should or has distributed cups with this particular design, which appears to be Mohammed Pedo Bear with a bomb turban. People have been shot for less. Good, bring him on. Right, Starbucks was for Christians in the end. Since coffee is part of the free market instead of the government, they were forced to listen to their customers, thank God. Now, something that you may not agree with me immediately on, but I'd like you to consider, is the following proposition. Catholics and Christians more generally have been right about everything. Christmas and Christianity are worth fighting for. Why? Because Catholics, in particular, and Christians generally. I mean, you're sort of like a slow relative, you know, like sort of. You know, you sort of you meet up with the family once a year, and little cousin Richard is in the corner. You know, it's how we like to think of Protestants, even though there are now quite a lot of you. The disease is spreading. What's that? Well, no, no, look. But we still love you. We love you. You're just a bit retarded. Anyway, you can read into most of what I'm going to say Christianity more generally, but I'm, of course, we'll be speaking about the purest and most excellent, best form of Christianity, which is Catholicism. There we go. Good. Perfect. We have some papists in the audience. Good. What's that? Oh, of course, of course, of course. Like, no, of course. Good Lord. Good. Can you imagine going to a mass? Can you imagine going to a mass in English? Ooh. And there's about four people know what I'm talking about, so let's move on. Christmas and Christianity are worth fighting for. They are. There's so many things we owe to religion as a debt of gratitude that the sort of smug Reddit atheists don't even know about and don't like to admit and sort of like rage quit when you bring up. Now, I can't listen to many of these debts of gratitude. I want to sort of turn this into a bit of a pep rally for Jesus, just briefly, just for 5 minutes, all right, to think about some of the things that Christianity has brought to Western civilization. Consensual marriage. Too much? No, not too much. Never. In the 12th century, so you weren't expecting me to start a sentence like that, were you, with this on the screen? In the 12th century, marriage came to be counted as a sacrament by the Catholic Church. And as a sacrament, it doesn't require a priest, only the agreement of the man and of the woman, which is the greatest protection ever given to women in the history of anything. By the Church's argument, women cannot be married against their will. They and the groom must say, I do. Think about that, ladies. Without the Catholic Church getting smart hundreds of years ago, you would have been married off to the highest bidder by your family today, which is one of my personal fantasies. But other people have different views, and most people would agree that mutually consensual marriages are a pretty good idea, so thank you to Jesus for that one. In the Islamic world, of course, girls are married off as little girls in some cases, following the example of the Prophet himself, and they share a husband with other women in others. And once you are married, heaven forbid you bring shame on your husband, like for instance by getting raped, because you might get caned, stoned, or suffer an honor killing. Even if we strongly dislike women's studies departments, we should be thankful they don't involve classes on proper burqa maintenance, because as bad as third wave Western feminism is, there are worse things out there. And that is thanks to the Catholic Church. This one is ironic. The education system is one of the... what? Oh, he's got it too. Must be one of those fancy calculators that does words. The education system is one of the most anti-Christian parts of America. You're existing in that system now. But it began life as a Christian endeavor. The first law in America to require general education was called the Old Deluder Satan Act, to teach children to read the Bible in 1647. 122 of the first 123 colleges in America were Christian universities. Think about Harvard. Harvard is about sort of the epicenter. Yale is probably takes the crown for the craziest campus in America. But Harvard is not too far behind. This is the founding statement of Harvard. Let every student be plainly instructed and earnestly pressed to consider well, the main end of his life and studies is to know God and Jesus Christ, which is eternal life. That statement would have today's Harvard students shaking, crying, and demanding safe spaces. Many of these universities have become sort of Christian in name only. DePaul, for instance, which now has one of the worst reputations for free speech. You're welcome. Anywhere in America, and they fucking deserve it. They deserve it. I don't know if you know the details of what happened to me at DePaul, but basically, I was speaking, I was in a very nice outfit. it's important to include the person in details. I was in a very nice outfit. I was doing a sort of a Q&A thing, and these guys charged the stage. One of them took a swing for me, you know, braver than that prick. The girl who was sort of like listless and drugged up was kind of like, you know, dancing and mumbling incoherently and all the rest of it. And Chicago PD were just sort of standing at the side doing nothing. And we found out later that university administrators had instructed them not to intervene. When a male Black Lives Matter protester charged the stage, physically threatened me, his little girlfriend thing, took a swing for me, snatching microphones, refusing to allow the event to proceed. There was a line of afros from girls whose boyfriends I'd fucked. And I said, I mean, I take some responsibility because when they were all lined up, I said, what are you complaining about exactly? And there was, oh, you know, the usual Black Lives Matter grievances. I said, well, don't you realize, sitting here, you're going to make the black incarceration rates go up even higher. You know, you're all about to get carted off. Anyway. I couldn't help myself. But DePaul instructed the police officers not to intervene. And then when I wanted to go back and speak again, they said no. Because it was unsafe. Yeah, for me! Anyway, DePaul, in theory, a private Catholic university whose presidents have been hauled into the Vatican multiple times to explain why it is that DePaul, a private Catholic university, has some of the most enthusiastic abortion advocates anywhere in the country. Anyway, America owes higher education and education in general to the Christian tradition, like it owes capitalism. Capitalism would have been impossible without the Protestant work ethic, and this is the one thing that our slow relatives, the Protestants, have given us. Catholics, you see, as you can tell from you know, their most fabulous proponents, are lazy, self-indulgent, and obsessed with you know, getting drunk and pleasing themselves. Just kidding, because we just get to say sorry and it's all right. The sort of puritanical Protestant work ethic is the main reason capitalism flourished. You know, capitalism was not possible without Christianity. America would never have been possible without the Protestant work ethic, informing and enlarging the achievements of capitalism. And here's a controversial one, science. Now, it's easy to... it's easy to look at a picture of Galileo and laugh when I suggest to you that the Catholic Church has been a good thing for science. And indeed, there have been some hiccups. But Western science developed in the way it did in the first place precisely because Catholics believed that God created everything. Which means it's all worth contemplating as the work of the Creator. That's what the Catholic Church believed, and the early scientists believed. That because the world had been created by God, it was worth inquiry, it was worth discovery, it was worth us finding out more about it. They weren't looking for the watchmaker, as some 17th and 18th century philosophers put it, but for the structure of the whole as a revelation of their maker. They wanted to find God in everything. And that's how science started. Now, without Catholicism, science would look completely different. And if you want to point out, as some people occasionally tiresomely do, that you know, science came out of Islam, or that Islam came, you know, kept maths alive and all the rest of it, that's only true in conquered territories. It was Christians and Jews and locals from other places under the Ottoman Empire and under various other bits of conquest from our Middle Eastern friends that kept things like that alive. It's a myth that we had some sort of dark ages in Europe while, you know, the Islamic Empire was flourishing and keeping it all alive. It isn't really true. It's just who happened to be in power at the time. The people in those countries are the same. So, a little like Western Europe today, France and the UK, you know, it's the same people, but it's, you know, Muslims holding the levers of power. Now, no lecture on Christmas would be complete without at least one Bible quote, and here is Galatians. There is neither Jew nor Gentile, neither slave nor free, nor is there male and female, for you are all one in Christ Jesus. Well, the Bible here is arguing against identity politics. It is. I mean, they didn't know about it then. But what they're effectively arguing for is a world not that dissimilar from the one envisaged by Martin Luther King. Identity doesn't matter because we are all equal human beings. Now, in their case, it's equal human beings under God. but it might similarly be equal human beings freed from the shackles of identity politics that insist on dividing us all by race, gender, sexuality. The most vibrant places on earth for the Catholic Church are in South America, Africa, and China, which is not really what you'd expect from a religion painted by the left as evil and white. It isn't. Why? Because of that. Now, separation of church and state. You know, sometimes we're just running late. This last one's especially ironic. Who'd imagine the Catholic Church practiced what so many on the left used to fight Christianity today? The ACLU gets the star taken down off the Christmas tree. How? By invoking separation of church and state. And the local town has to crumble because ultimately they would lose. But the Catholic Church practiced precisely this. The Catholic Church has always been held separate from the countries and the kings that ruled over Catholics themselves. Emperors and kings had to answer to the Pope in some cases, but the Pope didn't always win. And Philip IV's humiliation of Pope Boniface VIII is a perfect example of this, an episode of history with which I know you will all be intimately familiar. The important thing is that the Church was separate from the country, and that's been the case in almost all Christian countries for most of history. Protestants changed that, I have to tell you, leaving the religion of a land up to its rulers. And this is what happened when you got rid of the Pope. This is Henry VIII. Kings wanted to start being the head of the religion. We're smarter than that. We realized that this was a good thing. So the mingling of government and religion, which is a predictable nightmare, works about as well as Obamacare, is something that something that only happened after you wandered off the one true path. Now, Catholics also write about birth control and abortion, which we'll save for another day. And capitalism, as I said, would have been impossible without Christianity. But I'll leave you to Google those things to annoy your thin-skinned atheist friends. And we will return to why Christmas matters. Besides Christianity and specifically Catholicism being wonderful... Isn't that the real spirit of Christmas? A shit-eating grin and annoying all the right people. Yeah. Christmas is intrinsic to American culture, which is one of the reasons it's worth defending. I mean, who really needs anything more in life but all I want for Christmas is you? And there's so much joy in the American conception of Christmas, eating, drinking, sharing, and loving, making peace with family to whatever extent is possible. And we buy things. We buy things. Now, of course, the left hates Christmas for many reasons, but it hates Christmas partly because it is a colossal celebration of capitalism. And that's really great. In fact, you know, as I said earlier, Christianity and capitalism have always been really compatible in a way that some other faiths are not. And Christmas as practiced in America is almost the best example of capitalism in action, speaking of which I've got more things to give to you. Now this is the exotic chicken colouring book. A fun anti-stress colour... Oh, now I get it. It's an anti-stress colouring book. Does anyone have a feminist sister? You do? You want it for your feminist sister?
Yes. Oh.
All right, okay, go. If you're for the social justice warrior in your family, there's the chicken colouring book. There we go. What have we got here? An astronaut ice cream sandwich. What is that? Oh, it's freeze-dried. That sounds disgusting. There we go. Right. What are these little things? Nobody knows. Be careful. Nobody knows what they are. I promise there are no Lena Dunham books or little dildos or anything. Here you go, have some chocolate. Oops, there we go. Mind yourselves, be careful. They're going to get me for health and safety violations, I know it. Last but not least, oh no, wait, there's one here, look. What's this one? I don't know what it is. I actually don't know what any of these are. Well, I can't throw this because it's heavy. What about you? There we go. All right, last but not... Oh, God. Dreidels. Anyone want dreidels for the Jews? There we go. equal opportunity offender. Have some dreidels. I'll spin it. What's this? Oh, well, thank you so much. Oh, thank you. I love these. I'm addicted to Diet Coke. Thank you so much. These are actually just to keep away feminists, so you can't have these. These are with me. What is this? What is this? A mask. Anyone ugly? No, you don't want to push it. You keep standing up. You can. All right. I will sign the vagina monologues for somebody afterwards. There we go. And I've got... I don't know what it's for. Except for the obvious. Maya. I know about that. Who needs a little bedroom spicing up? Who needs... Now, I'm not going to throw it because it will hurt somebody, but you can have it. There you go. Tie somebody up this evening. You're welcome. Merry Christmas. Now, Western Europe has separated itself from the underpinnings of its culture, and you see the results on the news every day. America hasn't done it yet, and I hope you don't. As much as the left hates free speech, what drives them up the wall more than every dangerous faggot tour stop combined is the continuing existence of capitalism and family values. So make sure you have fun this Christmas, because nothing pisses the social justice warriors off more. It's even more fun. Even more fun. Pissing off your neighborhood campus crybaby. It's even more fun if there is one in your actual family. I don't think we have... No, we don't. Even more fun if there is one in your actual family. And what would Christmas be? What would Christmas be? I think it's him. I think he's destined to blog for BuzzFeed. Don't you think? Plaid shirt... The high prescription spectacles, little comb over, you little cuck. Right. little, what? Oh, he did? Oh. Oh, no, well, no, it's... Oh, maybe there isn't one. Okay, fine. Well, good. Thoroughly respectable. What would Christmas be? Let us wrap up, because I know you'll have some questions. What would Christmas be without mistletoe? Yes, we're going to get into rape culture. Everyone's favorite killjoys would like to get rid of this. They would like mistletoe to disappear because they are miserable cunts. Here is what happened last year. Say no to mistletoe. Feminists claim Christmas tradition promotes rape culture. This is the level of joylessness, lunacy and joylessness from the progressive left. Nothing to do with Subway at all. Sorry, Subway. You know, I had an idea. I might still do it just to annoy them. You know, Ben and Jerry's, the ice cream company, very progressive. Like, they have the craziest, So I'm thinking, on my bus, of getting a huge vinyl that says sponsored by Ben and Jerry's and just putting it on the back of the bus and making them sue me to take it off. You know? I think I might. Imagine the headline, Ben and Jerry's sues Miley Yiannopoulos to have logo removed from dangerous faggot tour bus. It's got to happen, hasn't it? Valentine's Day, of course, is a more well-known celebration of all things romantic, but Christmas is more fun. It's the season of Christmas office parties, mistletoe, everyone getting hammered and making out with the hot guy or girl that you've been looking out for all year. Or, in my case, having a train run on you by 6 drug dealers on the way home. Everyone's idea of romance is different. That's the great thing about freedom in the West. You can celebrate however you like. In an era when feminists are working tirelessly to ensure that both genders are terrified of coming within 10 feet of one another, women because they're afraid of rape culture, and men because they're afraid of false rape accusations, Christmas is needed more than ever. And that's how... That's how you know that... let me put it this way. Americans spend a lot of money on Christmas. It's a big part of the economy. The left likes to... Oh yeah, there he is, there he is. See, I knew I was just teasing. I know I was just teasing you, I fucking knew. It's in my slides, you idiot. Just kidding. What's that? You see, it's interesting that the only people able to successfully roast me are people in the audience who like me. Because we are. Because the social justice warriors just aren't fucking smart enough. They're not funny or clever enough. I mean, that was really funny. And what was the standard we had before? Milo, fuck you. You know? But, God, every morning I wake up and I'm like, somebody please get off a really good zinger, you know? Because it'd be great for YouTube. I mean, it's like, you know, you get to have a little moment, I get to have a little moment, I get to make a few hundred bucks off it on YouTube. Who cares? You know, it's fine. You know, everyone wins. But yet, alas, I remain tragically unroasted by the progressive left, but always my own audiences and always very effectively, fuck you. I don't even know who he is. All right. The left likes to pretend there's a problem with consumerism around Christmas. The truth is, just to return to this subject. Sorry, my crucifixes keep... it's fine, I'm sort of flanked by the good Lord. I'm doing his work, you know. Because as many of you will know who followed me for a while, God might hate fags, but he hates feminists a lot more. Now... Americans spend a lot of money on Christmas, and we're sometimes encouraged to believe that that's a bad thing, that consumerism is a problem. Well, it isn't. Jesus would have been fine with it. Capitalism's totally cool with Jesus. I, myself, am a believer in the prosperity gospel. Do you know what that is? Prosperity gospel means that God will reward you with riches according to how virtuous you are. So the better you serve him, the wealthier you get. I'm really rich. No, but it's a good rule to live by. It doesn't always hold, unfortunately. But I'd like to believe in prosperity gospel. Anyway, think about the lessons, just to wrap up, think about the lessons from Charles Dickens' A Christmas Carol. Now, unlike entertainment of today, where rich Hollywood liberals bellyache about other rich Americans, Ebenezer Scrooge isn't the bad guy just because he has money. Ebenezer Scrooge is the bad guy because of what he does with it. He's a bad guy because he lives a joyless and miserly existence and because he doesn't treat his employees well. Dickens' issue with Scrooge isn't that he makes lots of money. It's that he doesn't use any of it to help other people. Now think about all the good Scrooge does after he realizes the error of his ways. None of those things would be possible had he been poor. The reason it's a great redemption story is that Scrooge, freed from his miserly and selfish ways, is able to do good precisely because he's a capitalist. Precisely because he has enriched himself to the point where he can help others. He pays for Tiny Tim's medical treatment. I know. He donates to charity, he starts treating his employees better. He had wealth thanks to capitalism, but adding the Christian virtues of charity to his money made him an alright kind of dude by the end. We know that in general, conservatives who favor capitalism are more charitable than liberals who favor a big government. And you know, there's all sorts of studies on this that Christians, you know, good, decent Christian families in the South give a lot more to charity because they understand that it is better for you to decide with your money who you want to help than the government to take it off you in taxation. Because once charity happens in the form of taxation, all you're doing really is outsourcing the decision-making process. We all give to charity, all of us, even if we think we don't. Because what we've done is outsource the business of helping those in need to useless and completely incompetent people in Washington, rather than making a decision directly for ourselves about how much we give away and who we give it to. That's all the government is. That's what it's there to do. Now, when charity happens in the form of taxation, it turns us all into Scrooges. Because if you've given 30, 40, 50% of your income away. Why on earth should you give anything else, even so much as a smile? This is why Europeans all look so glum. Taxed at 70%, you'd be fucking miserable too. Why would you give so much as a passing smile to another human being when you are already working for them half the year already? From the 1st of January to sometime midsummer. You're already working for other people. Well, the rest of the year is fucking mine. And actually what you find is that people tend to give just as much, if not more, of what they have when you leave them alone to make the decision for themselves. And that process of giving and receiving at Christmas, and also the presents, is something that reminds us of the value of selflessness, generosity, altruism. Real altruism, not the sort of phony, feelings-based peacocking of the progressive left. From Black Friday through the last shipping day from Amazon, which is now the most important Christmas deadline, it's a very important day. You know, Christmas is a vital part of American culture. I'd like to finish with some homework. Now, it will surprise you to hear me recommending something from National Review, which is a magazine that used to be a great conservative, a great influential conservative magazine. Now something has its name, but it's sort of it's for the over 70s, like Fox, you know. Once in a while, National Review will publish something great, and David French, who is wrong about almost everything in National Review, has published something really great about why the media, people like me, journalists, generally get coverage of religion so badly wrong. And it's something to look out for when you're reading the newspapers, whether it's, you know, right-wing outlets that are frothing about the war on Christmas and you think, well, okay, it's a bit much, but there's something in here. Or whether it's left-wing outlets saying, you know, this is, you know, let's not be offensive to anyone. We're being culturally insensitive by going on about this Christmas stuff all the time. When you read, consider these things. And I think David French is right about all this stuff. I want you to look it up, but I'm going to give you just a little summary of what he says. He says, first of all, the media don't believe what religious people say. They don't believe that they mean what they say. Christians aren't against gay marriage because of what the Bible says, but because they're bigots. That's the media line, right? It's like, well, you're using your Christianity as a front. Actually, you just hate gay people. And the problem is they do the same thing with Islam and with jihadists. They don't believe that jihadis really do, out of some ancient, you know, need and impulse, want to conquer the West. They think, oh, no, it's our fault because, you know, we went in and invaded their countries and they're really miserable. They're really angry at us for history. No! The second problem is that the media assigns the failings of an individual to a religion as a whole. A sinner doesn't make the whole religion corrupt. Why are you all looking at me? Now, I am a sinner, but all people sin, and this leads us on to the third thing. And this is something that I get asked in the Q&As by people with alarming regularity, and it's annoying. And people say, well, how do you reconcile like being gay and being a Catholic? I'm like, oh. Well, first of all, two quotes. First of all is, you know, imagine how much worse I'd be without God. Second, you know, Catholic Church, the church for sinners. You know, people become Catholics because they know that they've got some way to go. People become Protestants because they're slow and they think they're great already. People join the Catholic Church because they know they have some way to go. But, you know, this is something, if you don't understand how religion works, if you don't understand that people are messy and complicated and that life is a journey, and you insist on this sort of, you know, silly ideological conformity that the left now does just to sort of try to catch people out, you don't understand that, you know, we're all messy and imperfect and we're trying to do our best. And we do our best. And some of the ways we do our best, you know, we come together in these moments like Christmas where, you know, everybody tries to make everything perfect. Everyone tries to make everything great. You know, the tree's got to look just right. And dinner's got to be ready at just the right time. When those moments, you know, our messy and complicated and difficult lives come together in just a fraction of a second, if we're lucky, every year for a few moments of harmony and happiness. And the search for that is a lot of what religion is about, and a lot of the reason people get comfort from it. So it's a lot more of a sophisticated and difficult subject. Reporters think they can do a quick Google search and be experts on religion. They can't, and most of what you read about religion in the media is total garbage. I just want to read one last bit of his article, and then we'll go to questions. Finally, in spite of the enormous diversity of human experience, there are still those, even in the ranks of reporters and pundits, who believe that all religions basically teach the same things. Experience with evangelicals and jihadists most clearly shows these distinctions. Evangelicals represent one of America's most generous and charitable communities. But for Mormons, were it not for Mormons, they'd be the most generous. Christians follow a God who gave his life on the cross. That's how you know. I mean, Feuerbach, who was a German philosopher, said that, you know, even if you don't believe in religion, look at religion, because it gives you a clue as to what people consider most important in life. So if you're looking at Christianity, you don't have to believe in God. But get your own need to say religion's for dumb people off the table and look at what this religion is telling you about the people who follow it. What is Christianity about? What's the central image of Christianity? Well, it is this. It is self-sacrifice. And what Christianity is telling you about the people who practice it is that Christians and the cultures that Christianity thrives in believe that the highest human virtue is self-sacrifice and love. That's what Christianity tells you. The people who follow it are fundamentally good, even if sometimes they get led astray. And contrast that, your homework is you can contrast that with other religions. Look for their central, look for their central moment. That moment of that most extraordinary, uplifting, ineffable, iconic moment. What is it? In Islam, I think, it's thousands of people circling the Kaaba during the Hajj. Total uniform compliance with the iron will of Allah. Islam is about submission and compliance, and indeed the name means submission to the will of God. Christianity is about something different. Christianity is about self-sacrifice and love. And when people think that all religions are basically all the same, and very smart people make this mistake. Christopher Hitchens made this mistake. Lots of people who wrote smart books on religion in that sort of militant atheist period we had in the last decade made this mistake. All religions are dumb. All religions are illogical. All religions are stupid. Well, they're not all the same. Some are better than others, just as Western values are better than Eastern values. Democracy, property rights, capitalism, the rule of law, freedom, all of the things that make America wonderful are better than anything you find anywhere else in the world. Cultural relativism, as practiced by the left, has made us all forget that. So you don't have to love Christians if you're not a Christian, but it would be worth remembering what Christianity has brought us, what Christmas has brought us, and what it means, and it would be worth reminding ourselves every once in a while when we get frustrated by the excesses of the progressive left and their insane, interminable, endless crusades to stamp out any kind of joy, love, and worship of God out of the public square, that our way is the best way. Thank you very much. I will be happy to take questions. Too many layers. All right, I'm happy to take some questions. Are you going to go around if I pick people? Is that all right? Thank you. You keep jumping up. I feel like you need to get something out of yourself. Go ahead. No, I'm grateful. I'm just teasing.
So earlier today, I watched an interview with Dave Rubin and Ben Shapiro. He had mentioned.
I'm sorry, did you run out of sleeping tablets?
I was waiting. Kind of boring, but one thing, Ben said some actually pretty good things about you, but Dave said something that you're going on in February and that he was going to bring up a discussion about maybe another scheduled or the first debate between you and Ben, if that were ever going to happen.
Well, I've repeatedly said I'm happy to do it, but Ben keeps fibbing about it. You know, I'm a lot busier than he is, and sometimes I don't respond to his emails within 3 days. I'm sorry. I mean, he's not high on my list of priorities. He used to be famous. He isn't anymore. You know, I prefer to debate people who, like, you know, when you're sort of your star is ascending very quickly, as mine is. You're advised to be interviewed by people who are bigger than you, not smaller than you, which is why Ben sort of fell off my list of priorities. And I continue to hold out that offer to him if he wants to take it, but he started fibbing on his radio show saying I was a coward because I didn't respond to him for a week. Well, get over yourself, you know? You used to be hot shit, you used to be the big thing, you aren't anymore. People are going to take a while to reply to you. I'm very happy to debate him, although I'm not sure he'll want to now that his access and influence has evaporated because Trump won. He didn't imagine for a second that Donald Trump would win, and now he has. You know, Ben's fucked for 8 years. Well, he deserves to be. He deserves to be, frankly, because he treated his own audience with disdain and contempt, and lost all of... I mean, he used to be the cool conservative, you know? Like, he used to be the guy that had fans under 50, unlike any of the rest of them. And then he fucked it all up with Trump. I mean, it's not my fault. But I'm very happy to debate him any time on any subject.
Sorry, I have one quick thing.
That's all right.
Maybe an attention grabber. Something that's not really important, but can you sign this hat possibly?
Yeah. Oh, of course, darling. Come up afterwards. We'll do it afterwards. Yeah, of course. Thank you, sweetheart. Yes. Yep. Yeah. Yes, you. We'll get someone up to you.
Hello. How do you feel about Million Dollar Extreme's World Peace being canceled?
Oh, it's so such a shame. Poor Sam. It's a perfect example of, I think he tweeted, this is a show on Adult Swim, claimed to be a sort of alt-right TV show, but he never really talks about politics. He's just a shitlord, you know, he's just a trolley, meme comedian. And it got canceled because Adult Swim actually don't have the same politics the rest of the entertainment industry have, and I think people made complaints about it, and that odious BuzzFeed blogger, Joe Bernstein, who has been blockhead. He is a blockhead. Deeply stupid person. It's a typical example, and I hate to say this, but since they're my people, I guess I can. It's a typical example of a sort of thick as pig shit media Jew who has all the sort of right PC politics, and totally predictable opinions on absolutely everything, but just really stupid, and seems to be driven by sort of social acceptance and political correctness rather than actually telling any interesting stories or doing anything worthwhile. But Bernstein's typical of that sort of, of that impulse in the media. He sort of went on this crusade about Sam Hyde, and because after Sam Hyde had sort of humiliated him with a very funny video you should look up. I think it's a shame when any free expression and creativity is censored at the behest of social justice warriors. I think it was particularly a shame for Sam because his show was edgy and funny, but I think also that that period in culture is coming to an end, and I think that very soon we're going to see studios emboldened to laugh the social justice warriors off the face of the planet. Why? Because Trump won, and these people aren't stupid, and they ultimately care about money. And Trump's victory has demonstrated there is a colossal market out there for people who really, really don't like feminism, political correctness, social justice, and all the other cancers that have infected American public life. There's a huge market for it, and there will be studios who are happy to capitalize on that and profit on it. And I think once that happens, it'll all be over very quickly, in the next 12 months, I would say. So it's a shame, but I think you'll get a show somewhere else eventually. Let's go. You've anticipated me coming this side. Let's go to the guy right at the back. Yeah.
I noticed that you mentioned the Protestant work ethic, and I was wondering if...
I don't have it.
Well, yeah. I was wondering if... I noticed a little bit of Niall Ferguson in your discussion of Christmas, and I was wondering if you draw a lot of inspiration from any of his work.
Yeah, I don't read him as closely as perhaps I should, but certainly I think we probably agree on that subject. If I can say this without throwing any shade at him, I draw more inspiration from his wife. Who I think is one of the most one of the bravest women on the planet, Ayaan Hirsi Ali, and so I probably read more of her than I do of him. But he's pretty sensible on most subjects. Yeah, it's one of the there are a couple of sort of celebrity historians. The majority of them are sort of they all seem to be gay for some reason, apart from him. A lot of the sort of TV historians, the ones that get the sort of grand epic shows and things, are all fags. Well, it's tiresome because it's distracting. I just want someone normal to tell me what happened, rather than this at the 18th century. Oh, so annoying.
No, but you know, you get these sort of like lispy queens, and I'm like, is this what people think gay people? Let's move on. I like him very much. I think he's great. yeah, in the black here. Yeah.
Two more questions, Milo.
Okay. Come on, run. Maybe we could do three. Notice I'm holding myself back.
Okay. So in social circle, sorry, I can't talk today.
That's all right.
Social circles all across the nation. Every group of men comes across the question, if you were forced to sleep with another man, who would it be?
Mm-hmm. They all answer the same.
Right.
Me.
Yes. You know, I'm really disappointed. I was exactly going
to
say that.
I know, everybody, but I wanted to take the compliment out.
Miley
of
and Apple.
Why let someone else pay you a compliment when you can do it yourself?
Yeah. Well done.
Thank you.
So, if you were forced to sleep with a woman, what would
it be? I wouldn't have to be forced.
Oh, no, of course not.
There are at least three women I can stand to be around for more than 5 minutes. Just kidding. I was telling UW Milwaukee my safe word. Women can be funny. just kidding. No, not Anne. I think of Anne as more of a sister, really. Who would I sit with?
Only Rosie O'Donnell. No.
No. He said woman. He said woman. No, would not be Amy or Lena. I think Sofia Vergara. You know, the one that plays the crazy housewife in Modern Family, who I think is lovely. In fact, I could take the couple, because he's great too. Who else do I like?
Amy Schumer.
No. In some states, that's bestiality, you know. You'd get locked up. It's like Norwegian whaling festivals, you know. It's true. Norwegian people are very strange, and it's partly because they've got too much money, because they've got all these natural resources. They have this whaling festival, and every year there's always a story about someone who gets caught at about 3 a.m. fucking a whale corpse. Always happens, and it always puts me in mind of Amy Schumer. As I say, illegal in 7 states. Who else? I like Salma Hayek, and who's the crazy one that is in Vicky Cristina Barcelona?
Penelope Cruz.
Yes, Penelope Cruz. Yeah. Thank you. All right, next. I have very gay taste in women, you know, sort of like brown, big hair, skinny, big tits, I know, but they look sort of Brazilian transsexual kind of thing. But what? Yeah, okay, go. Is this your son?
No,
because you're sort of like...
My son's over there.
Oh, well, hello. Okay, fine. No, go for it.
Okay, so...
I thought your mum was stepping in for you. I was about to roast you, but... No.
So, I just want to get your opinion. Were you honestly surprised about the constant call for recounts in all these states? Because
no.
Hillary Clinton was saying Donald Trump needs to accept the election, but after the election, it seemed a little ironic that she's not accepting it now.
Isn't it amazing? So, before the election, the rigged system is a vast right-wing conspiracy. After the election, we need a recount in every state. All this stuff. Before the election, Donald Trump's militia hate squads are going to go out exterminating Muslims. After the election, fake hate crime. And it's the left burning and burning, raping, and pillaging, like something from the Middle Ages. I was not surprised at all by that opportunistic cunt, Jill Stein, who's... only contribution. Well, she's just a sort of another Bernie Sanders, you know, sort of like 2 million, thanks. Oh, didn't work out, no refunds. I mean, don't left-wing people get it by now that everyone on their side is a fucking crook? Don't they get it? The Clinton Foundation, Bernie Sanders with his new house and boat, Jill Stein with her recount. Do they not get that their side is populated almost exclusively? sorry, almost exclusively by criminals. And, I mean, it's remarkable to me. No, I wasn't surprised by it, nor was I surprised by the results, which were almost uniformly Trump went up by a bit, you know, like 31 or 300 here and there. Very funny, very amusing. You know, you lost, get over it. And the reason I wasn't surprised about it is that the left are always sore losers. You know, and my experience watching as an outsider of this country from Europe, where we are a bit more sensible about these things on the whole, is that the Republicans and libertarians and sort of conservative nexus in this country tend to be more introspective after defeat. They tend to retreat, think about what went wrong, examine, you know, the failure of their cephalogy or their electoral strategy or their algorithms or their message or whatever, and try to do better the next time. The left cries foul, cries rape in the case of these fake hate crimes, tries to undermine the result, tries to undermine the legitimacy of the democracy, and looks for someone to blame. You know, everything that's now going wrong in America is Russian hackers. I mean, do these people not realize how they sound? Do they not get how mental they sound to the rest of us? Now it's all Russian hackers, name-calling, trying to blame everyone, you know, calling the conservative press fake news is their latest thing. Fake news. Fake news. You've got some fucking gall. Fake news. Fake news from the media that was telling us Trump couldn't win. Fake news from the press that was publishing polls with them 20 points apart, and then only on election night did the New York Times's, you know, likelihood of Trump winning go from 94%, you know, Hillary victory over the course of like 4 hours, and they didn't know beforehand. Of course they fucking knew. Fake news. Give me a break. And why? Because they're sore losers. They're liars, they are frauds, and they are sore losers. So it didn't surprise me in the least bit. Can we do one more? Yes, we can. Good. If I don't get a strong and immediate no, that generally means I can do what I want.
The microphone's already turned off. I'm sorry.
No, it's not. You just spoke through it. You just spoke through it. They think I'm stupid. They think I'm stupid. They think they can put Subway logos on things and I won't notice. Right. I want to go to... Yeah, sure. The blonde hair, I can't help it. I have to give mine a rest because I bleached it so many times, but I can't resist a blonde.
Hi, Milo.
Hi.
So, I was going to try and beat you to the punch, but you're talking Milwaukee, you talked about Rachel Dolezal. Mm-hmm. So, actually, me and this lovely lady next to me, last name Dolezal.
Oh.
Unfortunately, kind of related to her, but...
Oh, no!
I know, it's horrible.
When you say kind of, do you mean related to her?
I mean, our descendants came from a particular town in Czechoslovakia. So if there's any question that she was black, she's not.
Yeah,
she's not, about as white as I am.
It's not a black surname I know, and I'd only have to look through my phone book because they're all in there. Not a black that I've heard of. Yeah, carry on.
And so my question was, before yes. I thought that you were going to kind of go down the path of kind of with transgender and kind of, you know, changing yourself and how that's a mental illness, mm-hmm. Does she have a mental illness and should I get checked for it?
Is it congenital? Is it congenital? That's what you're worried about. You're worried if she's got this transracial genetic marker. Might you have it? Oh, I can understand why that might be a worry for you. Those lovely blonde tresses. You might wake up one day and they're frizzy and auburn, and then one day suddenly you've got a black afro. Heavens, almost overnight. You know, you find yourself. You pass out and you wake up in an atomic tanning booth. You don't know how you got there. Okay, I think there are people who have genuine mental dysfunction and are not fully aware of what they're doing. I think Sean King is one of those people. I think he has some kind of mental dysfunction. The fake black guy, Sean King, who has masqueraded as biracial his whole life to the point of taking an Oprah Winfrey scholarship and going to Morehouse College. I think he's broken. I have a feeling that your perhaps relative is more cognizant of what she's doing. I think that she is a lying opportunist who has recognized that there's no such thing as white privilege, but there is such a thing as black privilege. Being black enables you to say more, do more, get into more places, be more outrageous, take meaningless jobs with the government. There are obviously respects in which being born in impoverished African-American communities in this country really fucking suck. But if you're middle class, if you have access to things, it's very obvious that not having white skin is a really good career boost, just like it is being gay, because people are so desperate to up the diversity quotas in whatever, whatever. So for someone like her, not for everyone, but for someone like her, she wanted, I think, very cynically and very obviously, to acquire black privilege. She wanted to be able to bully, and she wanted to be able to not really work very hard for her whole life, and instead trade off an identity she instinctively understood carried more social weight and more social advantage than the one she was born with. She is, in all of her opportunism and her shameless dishonesty, the number one example for why this concept of white privilege is so obviously complete fucking garbage. So no, I think you're fine. I think you're fine. I don't think that you're going to catch anything or develop anything nasty. But you might want to change your surname. All right. Well, you know, these things just get poisoned. I mean, I know so many nice German people called Adolf. And it's just, no, and it's, their parents think it's okay now, and it's still not okay. It's still not okay. It's still not okay. These things get poisoned for you by other people, and in the end, you just have to give into it. Much as they did with the alt-right, you know, this was a movement that my colleague at Breitbart, Alleman, and I tried to give an accurate guide to. We tried to sort of sketch out the contours of that movement, but the press was so desperate to listen to a small but loud contingent of people in it who were, you know, insisting that it was a racist movement, that the word has now been taken from us to the point where I, you know, now have to dissociate myself from it. But once, sometimes words just go where you wish they wouldn't, like your surname. thank you very much for having me. Sorry about it. Thank you very much for having me. It's been wonderful. Thank you. Thank you. You're going to deal with this, right?
Hey, folks, if you can take a seat for me for just one moment, please. All right, folks, thanks very much for coming out this evening, or this afternoon, I should say. If you have a stamp on your hand that was given to you when you were checking in, indicating that you can stick around, smiley face stamp. Please go ahead and keep your seats right now. We'll do the meet and greet here in a little while. If you don't have that, unfortunately.